Alright guys, how's it going? I've been working on a different video for the past week, and then this dropped into my inbox. It's AMD's Ryzen 2000 series exposed, pricing and performance leaked. This comes from Video Cards through El Chapuza's Informatico, and they've apparently got hold of the upcoming Ryzen 2000 slides. Right, first up, I guess the big news right now at least is there's no Ryzen 7 2800X yet. So we appear to only have four models right now, Ryzen 7 2700X, the Ryzen 7 2700, the Ryzen 5 2600X, and the Ryzen 5 2600. Now this Ryzen 5 2600, I already talked about 6 weeks ago in my Tech Talk 3, and it was again through Video Cards. I believe this was a 3D Mark leak, or was it Geekbench, can't remember, one of those two. But anyway, the Ryzen 5 2600, which we know is a 6-core 12-thread CPU, had a base clock of 3.4 GHz and a turbo clock of 3.8 GHz. But now we appear to have a base clock of 3.3 GHz and a turbo clock of 3.9 GHz. So 0.1 GHz less base clock and 0.1 GHz higher turbo clock than this previous leak. At the beginning of this week, we started to see some more 3D Mark leaks coming through of the Ryzen 7 2700X, with a reported base clock of 3.7 and a maximum turbo of 4.125. And then we started seeing even more. The Cat of War, who is a viewer of mine, he's actually written a program to parse the results of the 3D Mark server, and he found the 2700X at 4.175, and then less than a day ago we saw a leak, a supposed leak, with the Ryzen 2700X and a boost clock of around 4.4 GHz. So this has all been happening over the past few days, with the leaks coming thick and fast. And as you can see here, the base clock does appear to be confirmed at only 3.7 GHz. But this is the 2700X, remember, with a turbo clock of 4.35 GHz. 105 watts TDP though, so that's 10 watts higher than the 1800X. And if you just look at it like that, 10 extra watts for 0.1 GHz base clock on a new process, that's not blowing me away. In fact, I'm pretty sure they could get that on the 14 nanometer process. It has been a year since Ryzen launched, and I am quite certain of the viability of a 3.7 GHz base clock on that improved node. The turbo clocks were a different matter, of course. As we know, Ryzen kinda pegged around 4.1. Based on this, I am simply not blown away. But let's move on and take a look at the slide deck. And we'll start with this one, the Ryzen desktop processor positioning. Now the first thing I want to say is, looking down at this date here, embargo lifts March the 15th, 2017. This would of course immediately raise a red flag, but there are numerous reasons for why this could still be there. It could be there just to catch out some leakers. AMD does do that. It certainly looks like a copy-paste, a Photoshop job, but in this case, it does not necessarily mean that it is a fake. It could just mean that this is an early slide deck, which makes sense because we already know from AMD that the Ryzen 2000 series will be launching in April. It's far too early for the press to have these slides, as we would generally get them a week to maybe 10 days before the product launch date. So if true, these haven't come from anyone in the press, it's likely been a leak from within AMD or possibly one of the motherboard guys. But starting off again, we have the four new CPUs. Now, I never actually said this in any of my previous videos, but when I looked at the competitive positioning between Intel and AMD, and then with the release of the 2400G and the 2200G, I thought that in this series, there may not even be any quad-core Ryzen CPUs, apart from obviously the 2400G and the 2200G. So this is my thinking. On the new 12 nanometer process, the entry-level desktop stuff would be 6 cores. At least I'm hoping that's the case, and we don't see any more quad-cores in the high-end desktop. I am long since over that crap. So that was my hope, and now this hope appears to be playing out, at least for now. But we can see how it's all lined up with the 2700X going up against the i7-8700K, and a dollar difference. Now, of course, that's an 8-core 16-thread AMD CPU up against the 6-core 12-thread Intel CPU. Below that again, we've got the 2700 coming in at $300, which is only $10 less than what the 1700 came in at this time last year. They put that one up against the 8700, and for me, the interesting one is the Ryzen 5 2600X at $250 against the i5-8600K at $258. That is of course 12 threads versus 6 threads at around the same price. Below that we've got the 2600 at $200 up against the i5-8600. And again for me, this is the big battleground. The 12 thread CPUs up against Intel 6 thread CPUs is pretty much where it's going to be won and lost. But moving on to the next slide, feeds and speeds. This is something that I would expect to see on an AMD marketing slide. They tend to use words like this, and that lends further credibility to the slides. We get a little bit more details here of the maximum boost of each part. The 2700 now boosting to 4.1, that's pretty good. But 4.25 of the 2600X, that looks pretty good as well. As you can see, DDR4 supported at 2933. This isn't big news because we already saw that with the APUs. We know that all Ryzen Desktop 2000 processors are compatible with AMD 300 series motherboards, but you will need a BIOS update. Now moving on to the next slide, once again we see this embargo lift of March the 15th, 2017. So it looks like another copy-paste job, but we've got the new AMD Wraith cooler, and I believe this is new, this new AMD Store MI, Intelligent Storage Acceleration for AMD Ryzen Processors. I can't recall seeing that one before, but I could be wrong. But moving swiftly on to the next slide, and we see that the Ryzen Desktop 2000 processors feature Precision Boost 2 and XFR2, and that they also feature improved Smart Prefetch. Again, another March 15, 2017 slide, but moving on to the new XFR2 and Precision Boost Overdrive slide, this one was fairly interesting. As you already know with the Ryzen 1000 series, Precision Boost only worked with two cores. So you had two cores at the boost clock and the rest were stuck at the base. Plus, of course, XFR adding another 100 or 200 in some cases. And we've already seen Precision Boost 2 with the 2400G and the 2200G. But now we're seeing this XFR2 enhanced mode, which by simply following the line, we can see that these new Ryzen desktop processors are able to maintain higher clock speeds on more cores. And finally, we have Precision Boost Overdrive, which if we just draw a line here from the old Precision Boost right to the very end, we can see that they can almost, maybe around about the 7 core mark, the new Ryzen 2 desktop processors should be able to hold around about the same turbo clock as the older Ryzen 1 series. Let's say on around 6 or 7 cores. So that would mean 4.1 GHz on 7 cores compared to only 2 as before. Now obviously in a multi-threaded load, that is going to be seen in a pretty decent uplift. Now I'm going to take a quick look at one or two motherboard slides before moving on to the interesting benchmark slides. As we know, it's a new 400 series, the X470s and the B450s, replacing the current X370s and the B350s. And as you can see, looking along the list, there is not an awful lot of change until we get to the end where, as we've already discussed, XFR2 Enhanced and Precision Boost Overdrive. These are not available on X370, but they are available on X470, and they will also be available on the B450s. Now, essentially, this could be about two things. It's either power delivery or segmentation. Regardless of which, it's a little bit annoying, but not really unexpected. We may see BIOS updates later on, especially with the X370 motherboards. Hopefully that is the case. But if you want these higher clock speeds, you're going to want to get a new motherboard. Really not impressed by that, but again, not surprised either. But it all makes sense based on power delivery. These performance increases here do not come free. There is, of course, a power cost. However, this power cost should have been mitigated by the 12 nanometer process. I guess we'll just wait and see how this one pans out. Now, looking at the motherboard vendors, Asus will have 7GB MSI 3, ASRock 6, and BIOSstar will have 2. And we'll be waiting a little while on BIOS updates from the big 3 being slightly put to shame by the smaller ASRock and BIOSstar. And the final motherboard slide points out the advanced design, optimized memory routing for high-speed memory support. With a bit of luck, that might mean 4GHz. Optimized VRM and power layout for CPU overclocking. This advanced efficiency one, quite interesting. The lower idle power is something that AMD has talked about in the past on the new X400 platform. Listen to what seems very good. And we've got stuff like advanced USB and finally advanced storage, again mentioning this Store MI. So that's pretty much it with the motherboard stuff. Again, not blown away by the lack of compatibility for XFR2 and Precision Boost Overdrive, even though I expected something like this. And I'll be surprised if we don't see later BIOS updates for the 300 series, or at least hopefully on the better models. But now moving on to what you all came for, the benchmarks. The Ryzen 7 2700X versus the Core i7-8700K. Down the bottom we can see it's a copy-paste over the Ryzen 5 launch, April the 11th, 2017 slide, but we've got this chart here. And again, this is just something that I would expect to see coming out of AMD. They are claiming a -7.7 FPS difference at 1080p Ultra with the GTX 1080. Now, this means that Intel CPU is of course faster, and we can see in the really old stuff like Skyrim and Counter-Strike, and also the CPU bound games like Overwatch, there is a large lead for the Intel CPUs. This is not about IPC, or not exactly. This is almost certainly about Ryzen's inter-CCX latency. But we're seeing an admission here that the 2700X is going to come in around 7.7% slower than the 8700K. But this is only with a GTX 1080, which is a mid-range graphics card. But with that said, we are still at 1080p. It's safe to say, again, I am not blown away with this result. And I do believe recently we saw a slide from AMD where the 1800X was supposedly only around 2% behind the 8700K. But in that slide, they were, of course, cherry-picking their best result. I guess if you look at it from that point of view, being only around 7-8% behind the fastest gaming CPU at 1080p is actually pretty decent. And it's pretty clear also that most of that lead comes from one or two ancient games. I understand what AMD is doing with these slides, but if they were smart, they wouldn't do it, because this simply gives ammunition for the press to use these games against them in reviews. And you know, you can make an awful lot out of 375 FPS against 275, and that is a 36% difference in performance. Nobody in the press applauds AMD for doing this, and you don't see Intel or Nvidia admitting their weaknesses. How you see that is entirely up to you. And then this final slide, once again, April 11, 2017, this one pits the 2700X versus the 1800X, with AMD claiming an average of 5% FPS increase, again at 1080p Ultra with the GTX 1080. 5% increase in FPS in gaming, this is pretty much what we have been seeing from Intel year after year after year. But there are one or two things to note again. The biggest increases have come in these CPU-bound games, as we can see here in Skyrim, almost 12% faster. But as you might expect, at a GPU limit, the average difference is really, yeah, it's around about 3, 4, 5%. Interesting though, and again another reason why I believe these slides are legit, is we can see at the end here, actually the singularity looks just to be a little bit below the 100% mark, or dead on, but in Crysis 3's swamp level, for some reason the 2700X, with its faster clock speeds which should be across the board, and its improved latency, appears to be just a little bit slower. And again, this is something that we have seen from AMD in the past. In the old Ryzen slides, they were happy to point out how poorly the 1800X performed in games like Civilization 6. Which in fact ended up to be completely untrue, as Ryzen performs very, very well in Civilization 6. Whether that was a patch or something else, I don't know. But again, we're seeing here that AMD is basically admitting that there could be cases where the 2700X performs worse than the 1800X, although to be fair, it looks like one case. But that is still a bit of a curiosity. It's possible that it's also just an error. Right, so finishing this one up, and that's why Cry says over at Video Cards that there is no Ryzen 7 2700X yet. This is a bit of a curiosity. I've had to think about it, and it could mean a couple of things. It could mean more than that, in fact. But if you think about Polaris, the graphics cards, before Polaris launched as the RX 480, we got used to AMD using 90 for the top graphics model. But the RX 480 was only really about the same performance level as RX 290X, RX 390, 390X. And they would have been slammed had they released that card as the 490. So maybe there's a bit of concern here that if they launch this new Desktop 2000 series with the flagship model being the 2800X, but only with a 0.1 GHz base clock increase, and granted a nicer turbo clock, but at an increase in TDP. This is something that I don't think many in the press would be celebrating. So with that in mind, people maybe look at this and think, oh, the 2700X, that's actually quite nice. It's faster than the old 2800X, albeit slightly, and surely there will be a 2800X coming. But if there was a 2800X coming at some point in the near future, then, you know, why not mention it on one of these slides? I don't know why they wouldn't do that. It's possible that there may be a 125-watt Ryzen 7 2800X coming, perhaps with a base clock 3.8, 3.9, maybe even a turbo of 4.5 max, and for me that would have been the bare minimum. So this 2700X thing, it could be a bit of a Jedi mind trick, making us think there's something faster out there, and making it look like the series has progressed further than it actually has. Right now, we simply don't know. Again, looking at 2600X, this is the interesting one for me. $250 price point, that should put an awful lot of pressure on the i5-8600K. I would have liked to have seen this be a bit cheaper than $249 though, but the fact here is, AMD does not seem interested in fighting any kind of price war with Intel, and I guess looking at it logically, that's the smart thing to do. But this looks like our new Ryzen Desktop 2000 series lineup. Obviously, we're going to get Threadripper later on. Perhaps the very best chips are being held back for Threadripper, and that would help to explain a lot. But for me, that is a poor strategy, as AMD should be doing absolutely everything they can to close this 7.7% average gaming gap, which will be more with a faster graphics card, make no mistake about that. And I don't feel that holding back the better silicon for the extreme high-end desktop Threadripper CPUs is a good idea, assuming that is their plan. At the silicon level, this is extremely poor, 3.7 GHz over 3.6, with an increase in TDP on a new process. I'm sorry, I'm just not blown away by that at all. And I get it, the process isn't quite the dumb shrink that we thought it was, but we've heard 10% coming from AMD before, we've heard 10% coming out of GlobalFoundries. It does not take a genius to figure out that 3.7 GHz is not 10% faster than 3.6 GHz, which, as we know, is the base clock of the 1800X at 95 watts. The turbo clock, again, this is a mix of architecture and improved process. And I guess if you take the turbo clock of 4 gigahertz of the 1800X, then they just about made 10% there. But this is your turbo. But how good this really is will depend on the maximum frequency of the 12 nanometer process. 4.5, it's pretty much what we expected. But I can't help but feel slightly disappointed at any rate. Because that single thread advantage Intel has, there is still a gap there. And I'm not sure this is enough to really close the gap. But in multi-threading, this 2700X should be a monster of a performer. There's no reason to believe that with sufficient cooling, and of course your X470 or B450 motherboard, we could possibly be seeing 4 gigahertz on all 8 cores. That's a beastly CPU by any stretch of the imagination. But summing this one up, that pretty much looks like what we're getting. You're going to get strong, strong multi-threaded performance with better single-threaded performance. It's going to come at a power penalty, but they should still be comfortably around the same level as Intel. Right now, it looks like anyone with a Ryzen 1000 series desktop processor will be skipping this generation and looking towards Zen 2. But I'm done with this one. Don't forget to check out all my links in the description below. Hit the like button, subscribe if you haven't already. I'm heading back to Scotland this week and I'll hopefully get this other video done before too long and also get myself back on track in my own environment. I'll catch you later, guys.